Love is possibly one emotion which is explored by every artist, big or small. Under such circumstances, the creator has the responsibility, or should I say the challenge, of not tickling the obvious responses. Julian Barnes manages to produce a novel on the same subject written by a million creators, but still he produces something new, avoiding most pitfalls. Hi, this is Gautam, and for this episode, we will be diving into the book, The Only Story, written by Julian Barnes. The book is divided into three parts and is mostly written in first person. The protagonist, Paul, starts the book with a brilliant monologue on love and then explains his unconventional relationship. Unconventional even by modern standards. 19-year-old Paul falls in love with 48-year-old Susan. The story is set in 1960s South England, and the story is actually set in a village, literally. Susan and Paul are paired for a mixed doubles match. They get paired for the first time, they lose the quarterfinals, but still they win two matches, so they develop a sense of respect for each other's game. And they start by sharing trivial things. Paul is a third year student in college, whereas Susan is married and she has two daughters. Both of them are older than Paul. What seems to be an unconventional bond slowly develops into an organic relationship. He starts to drop her in her house every day, pretty much every day after the tennis practice sessions. He starts to solve crossword with her own husband. He begins to stay more in her own house, and then he starts to lie to his parents. As the distance between their bodies disappear, so does the acceptance for others. With a runaway fund, which is arranged by Susan, both Paul and Susan leave their respective homes and buy a house for their own. Few rooms in the house are rented for money, and Paul begins to pursue law. Of all the metaphors which can be assigned to time, cruel is worthy. Time deprives humans of everything: their health, the relationships, their strength, and love. The relationship between Susan and Paul turns alcoholic literally, as Susan becomes an addict. Their love, which blossomed on the green, lustrous grass courts with the smell of fresh chalk powder, dissolves in an unglamorous whiskey bottle, dissolving in the stench of liquor. It would be wrong to dismiss the story as just one another story which reinforces the fact that love is blind. No, the story is not about that. The author allows the reader the liberty of trying to assume what happened or what could have been the reasons why Susan turns an alcoholic after moving away from Paul. Susan herself was married to an alcoholic domestic abuser, and she's the mother of two daughters, and her relationship was really not working, or should I say, her marriage was really not working. And even if she moves away from her very old, sore relationship, Susan has crossed an age where she is unable to overcome her past and her responsibilities, and that guilt slowly eats Susan alive. Paul, on the other hand, was only 19, and he becomes 20, 21 and 22, and he's not really able to appreciate the factors like social well-being, reputation. And Paul realizes these things only when he becomes older, and then he understands maybe this might be the reasons why Susan was forced to consume more alcohol. Paul's first love perennially affects all his future relationships, and even if he's able to make peace with himself, he's never really able to ignore Susan, because his first love was very pure. And I'd like to read a passage where Paul is in conflict with himself, and he realizes that even if he doesn't really like the relationship, he cannot move out of this. It's page number 1133 from the book. So I'd like to read that. It's a monologue. It's written in first person, Paul's first person. It goes like this. I said, I never kept a diary. This isn't strictly true. There was a point in my isolation and turmoil when I thought writing things down might help. I used a hardback notebook, black ink one side of paper. I tried to be objective. There was no point, I thought, in merely venting my feelings of hurt and betrayal. I remember that the first line I wrote down was this: all alcoholics are liars. This was obviously not based on a huge sample or broad research, but I believed it at the time and now. decades later, with more field experience, I believe it to be an essential truth about the condition. I went on. All lovers are truth tellers. Again, the sample was small, consisting mainly of myself. It seemed to me evident that love and truth were connected. Indeed, as I have said, that to live in love is to live in truth. And then the conclusion to this quasi-syllogism, therefore, the alcoholic is the opposite of the lover. This seemed not just logical, but also consistent with my observations. Nowadays, a lifetime later, the second of those propositions seems the weakest. I have seen too many examples of lovers who, far from living in truth, dwelt in some fantasy land where self-delusion and self-aggrandizement reigned, with reality nowhere to be found. Yet even while I was compiling my notebook, searching to be objective, the subjective kept undermining me. For instance, I realized, looking back at our time in the village, that whereas I thought of myself as both lover and truth teller, the truths I told were only to myself and Susan. I told lies to my parents, to Susan's family, to my own close friends. I even dissembled at the tennis club. I protected the zone of truth with a rampant of lies. Just as she was now lying to me all the time about her drinking, as well as lying to herself, and yet she would still affirm that she loved me. So I began to suspect that I was wrong in considering alcoholism as the opposite of love. Perhaps they were as much closer than I imagined. Alcoholism is certainly just as obsessive, as absolutist as love, and maybe to the drinker, the hit of booze is as powerful as the hit of sex is to the lover. Read the book if you want to understand and relish love rather than judge it. Because once the final pages have passed through, you just go through the back cover, you feel that you've stranded in an island of love, that the food resources are declining. And even if you want to leave the island, somewhere inside it just holds you to stay back. You become so obsessive with the island that even if death arrives, you're ready to stay with death because it's the island which you want to be. So that's the end of today's review. Meet you with the next book soon. If you like the video, do like, comment and subscribe. That's it for now.